title of today's message is Living with an Eternal Mindset. This is part two. We're going to focus today on the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. Before we begin, I just want to thank the praise team for getting us positioned to be in the right place to receive the Word of God. Thank Brother Willis for bringing forth the Word of God to prepare the way. And thank you all for your support today. Mm-hmm. God's got a good word for us. Amen.
Amen.
So let us get ourselves in the right position to receive it, not just to receive it, but to act on it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So last time we talked about eternal judgment. And we said that eternal judgment is a foundational doctrine that every Christian should have sound knowledge about. We talked about last time that we have many believers that don't have that sound understanding of what eternal judgment is. We basically talked about there are two types of judgment. The first type of judgment that we talked about last time is how we respond to the cross of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to say this in another way. Do we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and eternal judge? And this type of judgment that we talked about determines where we will spend eternity. So this differentiates the believers from the non-believers.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember last time we looked at the passage in Scripture where it talked about Jesus told the passage about the rich man and Lazarus. And then once we talked about this first type of judgment, about where we will spend eternity, we talk about the second type of judgment. And this second type of judgment is how we respond to eternal judgment at the seat of Jesus Christ. Amen? So this judgment seat is for believers only. And this judgment determines how we will spend eternity in heaven. We talked about that rewards will be given at the eternal, the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. But these rewards won't be equal.
Mm-hmm.
We said that everyone has an opportunity to receive every reward that's available to them. But our decisions, while we're here on earth, they determine what rewards we will receive for eternity. And this ties with our knowledge, our belief, and execution of Jesus' covenant plan for us while we're here on earth. And we talked about this life here on earth. And although that this life on earth, in comparison to eternity, is like a passing vapor, even though it's like a passing vapor when you compare the two, but what's important about this time here on earth is that the decisions that we make while here on earth are so critical to in regards to how we will spend eternity in heaven. So today, I'm going to be focusing on the judgment seat of Christ for believers. And we're going to discuss two major categories that believers will be judged by. And then we're going to focus on one of those categories today and examine the details so that we have sound knowledge regarding what's expected of us as believers. Amen?
Amen.
So when we look at the judgment seat of Jesus Christ for believers, there are two major categories in which believers will be judged by. The first one is our involvement in the building the kingdom of God in accordance with our calling and gifts. The second one is in regards to our progress and development in building our individual lives. And what influence did we have on others' lives as well? So what's key to both categories is how we cooperate with God's grace in developing the Christ-like characters that he expects. How do we respond to God's word? What we believe, our, in our obedience to what we receive, our action, our works, our thoughts, and our motives will all be examined at this judgment seat of Christ. So our focus today will be to examine the judgment of our roles in building God's kingdom and our ability to build the kingdom of God with accordance to our callings and our gifts. And this is entirely, these callings and these gifts and our responsibility is entirely based on our obedience to the Holy Spirit. So let us go to the title scripture and let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I said verse 10, but let's start at verse 9. When you get there, say Jesus is Lord.
Jesus Lord.
1 Corinthians chapter 3, we're going to look at verses, start at verse 9. And it starts off at verse 9. It says, "For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building." Verse 10 says, "According to the grace of God which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereon. For other foundations can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." Verse 12 says, "Now if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is." So verse 14 says, "If any man's work abide which he had built thereupon, he shall receive a reward." And then verse 15 closes and says, "If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire." So this judgment is not talking about whether or not we're going to heaven or hell. This judgment is for believers. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I want you to get out of this type of scripture today is we can't do anything with eternal value unless it's by the grace of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. If we do things and it's not given to us through the power of the grace of Jesus Christ, it's just like it's built with wood, hay, or stubble. Mm-hmm. When it's tested by the fire, it goes up in smoke. It has no eternal value. Mm-hmm. There's a scripture in Psalms, I think it's Psalms 127:1. It says, talks about that we can't build apart from the Spirit of God because it's worthless in the sight of eternity. We can't do anything without the Spirit of God behind it. It will be burned up at the judgment seat of Christ. Mm-hmm. And that's a very important scripture that we must understand. We can't do nothing without the power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit and the grace of Jesus Christ to help us. Because if you think about this. How can we impress God with our own power? Think about that. Mm-hmm. How can we impress the Creator? You know, Isaiah 66:2 says that heaven is his throne and the earth is his footstool. Mm-hmm. So, Jesus, if we're thinking that we can build something for Jesus, the Lord is saying, "What kind of house can you build for me? All right. I created the whole universe." All right. You know what the Lord gets pleasure at? The Lord gets pleasure at seeing his people be humble, mm-hmm. be repentant, be respectful of his authority, mm-hmm. and people that obey his command. The thing I want us to get out of this is We can't create anything that God is in need of. We can do nothing in our own power, in our own strength to serve and please God. He doesn't need us, church. We need him.
That's right.
And that's the problem today. We're looking for power from man and from system, worldly systems, and it's not going to work.
Amen.
The power comes from Jesus, from the Holy Spirit, from the grace of Jesus Christ. But here's another point that I want to make sure that we understand, church. As powerful and as awesome our God is, by his own choice, he restricted himself in what he does on the earth. And what I mean, because if you remember in Genesis, he delegated his authority to the earth to man. He gave it to Adam, right? Mm-hmm. And we see examples in the Bible where we see the restriction of his authority, his power, because of what man does. I remember in Psalms, they talk about Abraham's descendants. And they said that Abraham's descendants limited the Holy One of Israel. And I remember in Mark, Jesus was talking to the church, and he was saying to the religious leaders in the church, he was saying that they were nullifying and making void of no effect the authority of the Word of God through their tradition, through their religion. Mm-hmm. So that in itself, that gives you evidence that, yes, God has power, but he's delegated this power on earth to us. Mm-hmm. We restrict the power that we have by not following him, by following tradition, by following religion. That's what limits. We're the limiting factor. He's not the limiting factor. And see, we as believers, we are responsible to cooperate with God to fulfill his desired goal, which is to have his people conform to the image of Jesus Christ.
All right.
In whom and likeness, in whom he can inhabit these people for eternity. For this reason, and this is what it says in our scripture today in 1 Corinthians 3:9, we as believers are described as being co-laborers with Christ. So in the New Testament, when we see the word labor in scriptures, it's associated with either working on a building or working in a field. And I was like, well, Lord, why is that? Why are you using that word in that context? And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and says, he said, you really know why I'm using it in this context? He says, because the earth is the field where the growth of the kingdom of God occurs. Mm-hmm. And as we work, as we labor in building God's kingdom, using his power, his grace to empower us, heaven rejoices and cheers us on.
Okay.
But you see, we gotta cooperate with God and use his grace to do that, to be successful. Jesus is looking for a permanent place to dwell. And you know what? We are those living stones, as the scripture describes, that compose of his dwelling place. Mm-hmm. So in essence, not only are we as believers, not only are we responsible, are we builders of the kingdom, but we're also the kingdom itself. We're the materials as well. Mm-hmm. So let's go to the scripture that shows it. We're going to go to Ephesians chapter 2. Go to Ephesians chapter 2. And we're going to look at verse 20 and 21. Mm-hmm. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20 and 21. Okay. Get that saying, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
I'm going to go and start at verse 19. It says, now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Our reason for being on earth is to build up God's house, mm-hmm. whether it's by serving, teaching, ministering, evangelizing, or whatever it is. We as believers have roles as a pure living stone. We're part of the building, and we're also a builder, mm-hmm. one who causes the living stones to be fitted and joined together into a glorious house for the Lord. Amen? Right. This describes both the personal and kingdom responsibilities we as believers will all give account to, church.
Mm-hmm.
This responsibility is not for the pastor, not just for the pastor or the church leaders. I'm speaking the truth. It didn't say anything about pastors and leaders. It's for everybody. This mm-hmm. responsibility is for every believer.
Amen.
Leaders, of course, will be held to a higher standard, you know, versus the men. But we all play a role in building the kingdom of God. That's what uh-huh. we gotta look at. We're all builders. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Just think about it. Let's think about this example. Let's say I'm going to build my dream house. I'm a custom builder. I'm going to build my dream house. Design this magnificent dream house, right? But before we can do any physical work on this house, there must be a design and a plan of construction, right?
Right.
And this consists of drawings, and based on those designs, it determines what kind of materials that are going to be required to build the home, right? The crucial part of building a home is scheduling the work to be done, right? And because you got concrete foundation, you got your framers, you got your roofers, you got your bricklayers, you got your roofers, you got your electricians, you got your tile people. These people, we call those people the subcontractors, right? And those subcontractors are the one, those are the people who actually build the home. And the scheduling piece is very critical when building a home because it can cause chaos, right? You can't have the sheetrock subcontractors come in if the electrical wiring is not done, right? You can't bring the bricklayers in if the frame and all that's not set up, right? What happens when bad work is done by the contractor? Sometimes as a builder, you gotta remove that subcontractor and find a replacement subcontractor to replace it. And what they end up having to do, if the work is so bad, they have to tear down the work that has been done and start over again. You gotta find the right subcontractor to build your home with, because you gotta make sure that they not only do they do quality work, that they use quality materials to get the job done with excellence, right? So I'm taking you there because I want you to look at this from a spiritual sense. Do you know that God is the custom builder of his own house, his spiritual house?
Mm.
And his house is made up of a city of people, city of believers. And you know, like houses has names for their house. You know, like today in Washington, D.C., the home of the president is called the White House. And I'm gonna go back to Memphis because we live in the Memphis area. Memphis, we have the place where Elvis lives. There's a name for that house, right? It's called Graceland. But you know, God has a name for his house.
Mm-hmm.
You know the name of God's house? It's called Zion. Mm. That's the place where God's, that's his home. And we see that in a Psalm. Let's go to Psalm. I want to show y'all this. Psalms chapter 13. He has a house. These other houses don't have anything compared to God's house, this house of Zion. We're going to look at Psalms chapter 13. Oh, I'm sorry. Psalms chapter 132. Psalm 132. I wrote it down. That's okay. Psalms 132. We're going to look at verse 13 and 14. Yeah. You just say Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
It says, for the Lord had chosen Zion. He had desired it for his habitation. This is my rest forever. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. The Lord's been working on his house for a while now, you know. And he's laid out the plan before man was even placed on earth. One thing he knew man was going to fall. But the Lord had a plan to build Zion out of a redeemed mankind. And so in Isaiah 28:16, the scripture says that the Lord laid a stone in Zion, in his house, a tested stone, a precious stone for a sure foundation. That ties into our title of scripture, doesn't it? We talked about that cornerstone. Mm-hmm. That stone was Jesus Christ. Jesus is not only the foundation and chief cornerstone, but he's also the chief subcontractor of our spiritual house, church. One thing about Jesus as a chief subcontractor, and I know this, and we know this, he didn't miss his assignment.
Right.
He executed his assignment perfectly.
Yes, he did.
And he said to the Father right before his crucifixion, he said, I have finished the work in which you have given me to do. Mm-hmm. And after the Father scheduled Jesus, the chief contractor, at the appointed time, what he did then is he scheduled the rest of his subcontractors. You know who the rest of his subcontractors are? It's us.
Yeah.
We are those subcontractors.
Mm-hmm.
This, just like Jesus, we serve not only as a subcontractor, but we're also the materials of the spiritual house. We are the living stone. So we have a twofold. We work twofold. So I think we talked about this a little bit in Sunday school. This was our last verse in our Sunday school lesson today. Ephesians 2:10. We know this one. It talks about, for we are God's workmanship, right? Mm-hmm. Created in Christ Jesus to do good works. God prepared in advance for us to do. That was our last verse in our Sunday school lesson. Our assigned task as subcontractors were prepared in advance. So our personal assignments as believers were planned in advance. All right? So based on scripture, we know, every one of us know, that God has set up a plan for each one of us.
Yes, yes.
The question we have to ask ourselves, church, is this. Will we execute the plan that God has for us in our lives?
Uh-huh.
So I want you to look at this. And, let's go to the, we don't know any songs now. Let's go to Ecclesiastes. We're going to look at chapter 3. We're going to look at this a little bit further. Ecclesiastes, we're going to look at chapter 3. That say Jesus is Lord. I'm trying to take this home so we can understand this. God has a plan for all of us. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, we're going to look at verse 14 and 15.
Jesus is Lord.
All right. It says in verse 14, it says, I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. And God doeth it that men should fear before him. That which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been. And God required that which is past. So what that verse is saying in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 14 and 15 is that God has a plan, and nothing can take away from it being accomplished. Not even ourselves.
Okay.
Things being accomplished now were in God's mind beforehand, as well as what's to be accomplished in the future. Mm-hmm. That's already in the plan of God. And the other thing that we must understand is we must all give account for that which has already been done. Did we walk in what God ordained for us to fulfill? Did we mess up his assignment or miss our assignment? Did he have to assign someone else to do what we were called to do, church. The key point we need to understand is this, and I'm going to focus on this. In regards to our personal calling, we as believers will not be judged according to what we did, but instead according to what we were called to do. I want you to understand that. In regard to our personal calling, we will not be judged according to what we did, but according to what we were called to do. And I want you to understand, I've seen many and witnessed many people who missed their destinies. Mm-hmm. Business people that were in the marketplace that were destined, their calling was to be in ministry, but they made that choice to be in business. Mm-hmm. And vice versa. There's some people who just went into the ministry. They weren't called to be in the ministry. Mm-hmm. They were called to be somewhere else. So I don't want to make it seem like not everybody's going to be a pastor. Not everybody's going to be certain parts of leadership. God has a place and a purpose for everybody in the church.
Amen.
And sometimes we miss our assignments because we're not seeking God for wisdom and guidance when we're making those decisions. And I've seen people fall off as an example of that. I've seen people marry out of the will of God. Mm-hmm. And it ends up interfering in their divine calling. And these are all unfortunate stories. But you know what, church? There's some good news I'm going to tell you. Mm. Right now, today, while we're here today, church, we have a choice to not let people or circumstances keep us from God's plan and a calling in our lives. So somebody may be wondering today at this moment, you know, and young people, I want you to listen in too. I want you to really dig in and listen. And you may be asking yourself this question. Everybody may be asking this question now that I brought this up. Well, how do I find out what God has called me to do as a spiritual subcontractor? So if you have this thought in your mind, we're going to cover three questions that we should ask ourselves if we are struggling with knowing God's divine plan for our lives. So we're going to start with question number one. Mm-hmm. First question you need to ask yourself is this. Have I sought God earnestly?
Mm.
We're going to go to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Y'all know this, I said this scripture during praise and worship today. Mm-hmm. Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to look at verse 6. Y'all know the scripture.
Yep.
Get there, say
Jesus is Lord.
All right. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't say casually seek him, right?
Mm-mm.
Didn't say periodically seek him. It said diligently seek him. So seeking him requires having a correct relationship with Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
That requires us spending time in his word. That requires us spending time talking with him and not only talking, but listening to him in prayer.
Right.
And one thing that's beautiful about the Lord is when we seek him, you know, like the scripture said, you know, it says, ask him and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Mm-hmm. If we seek him, he's going to be right there. And one thing that's good about us seeking, when you seek him early, the Lord will give you an overall picture of your life's calling. He will show us the end from the very beginning. You remember how he showed that to Joseph? You remember how he showed it to Moses? You remember how he showed it to David? You remember how he showed it to Peter? Church.
Mm-hmm.
He had already. He gives us that vision if you seek him. But you know, in all those cases, those men in those examples, they were seeking God. We get the same thing. And I'm going to give you that personal example. God had showed me a while back that I was going to preach his word. I wasn't too keen with the notion at first, you know. And I knew I was going to end up being where I was, but, you know, I was having doubts, you know. We have doubts. And, but it's amazing how God took, you know, I was in New Orleans at the time. And God had, you know, I thought this was going to be home for me. New Orleans was going to be home for me and my family. And we were only there, well, I had been there longer, but London and Kenny had only been there for about 4 or 5 months. My job got eliminated. I had to go somewhere. So I ended up, God blessed me with an opportunity to come to International Paper. And we moved to Shreveport. And I worked at the mill in Mansfield. And I was there for 5 years. And while I was there, I was going to church. And I had my, you know, we had one particular Sunday where the pastor was not able, he was out of town. And he needed somebody to bring the message. And so he asked me to do it. So that was my first time. I had never brought forth a message before. So, you know, I could see God just, you know, I look back, I was reflecting on God had prepared me. I was preparing me. So I got up and I was able to do my first message that time during the service. And, you know, I looked at different areas in my life where he's planted me, where I had to train people, I had to teach people, I had to stand up in front of people. And then, you know, after my time in Mansfield, I ended up, my job was eliminated there. I come to Memphis. And then I end up having lunch with this minister named Ron Spread. You know, we were looking for our house, and God just positioned. And next thing you know, I ended up being a member. I'm a member of this church, and I started working in the different ministries. I started being a part of the music ministry. I started working at youth. I became a deacon. And you see this whole process of God just developing me, put me in the right place. And now it's just kind of, it's coming together. And then the next thing you know, I was like, I'm ready for you to step out. You see how God had orchestrated all that, those things? And that, but you have to continue to see you earnestly throughout the whole path. But you may not know how you're going to get there, but all you got to do is continue to seek him. He'll keep leading you. He'll keep, and I'm just giving you this message because all these experiences helped me and developed me and prepared me to be where I am right now. Amen?
Amen.
So just think about that. So I talked about being planted where I am today in this church. And this is the second question we got to ask ourselves, church. Question number two. Have I planted myself in the local church?
Mm-hmm.
We're going to go to Psalms 92. Have I planted myself in the local church? You look at Psalms 92, verse 13. Get that, say Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
He says, those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Ooh-wee! Many don't find the will of God for their lives because they haven't planted themselves in the local church.
Mm, all right.
When planted in the local church, people will flourish in his courts, in the Lord's courts. This flourishing now occurs not only now, right? But it occurs later in this as well. So this courts of our God, it represents not only our time here, executing here on earth, but it also reflects eternity. Because the things that we're doing, if we're planted in the church and we're doing things out of the grace of God, then it's going to be, there's going to be rewards that happens for us now, and it's going to be later. It's eternal rewards.
Mm-hmm.
So, the master builder has designed this in his manner. And I want to show you why. It's, Jesus says in Matthew 16, verse 18, he says, I will build my church. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against this, against it. So, how can Jesus build his church? without physically being here. Mm. You want to know what the answer is? Through his body.
Yep.
Which is all of us.
Yes.
We are the body. Mm-hmm. This confirms why we're co-laborers, because we are building his church using his divine power system. Mm-hmm. So I have a self-examination question for all of us right now. Are we building this church with his divine power system, or are we using our own strength?
Mm.
Are we using our own strength? We see in scripture that the church is known as the body of Christ. Just as the overall church is broken down into local churches, the overall body of Christ is subdivided into local bodies. And the key message I want to share about being planted in the local church is this. The Lord is the one who places his people into the appropriate local body of church. We don't choose it. He is responsible for choosing it for us. You know something? Folks are picking churches like they pick restaurants to go to.
Hey, go on preaching.
They're not asking God what he desires for them. You know? And the issue is this. If you're not seeking God, seeking his guidance, and picking a local church, how are you going to fulfill his divine calling for you if you planted in the wrong location of his body? Think about a plant. Now, I know we got some forestry resource people that are members here, and y'all understand this. Y'all would understand this and appreciate it. I think we all would. Think about a plant. What would happen if you uproot and replanted every 3 to 4 weeks? What's going to happen to that root system? It's going to weaken it. And it's going to prevent it from flourishing. That's what happens to believers when they jump from church to church. And one of the things that's a problem is folks get offended because they don't like the decisions that leadership makes, or they feel like they're not being appreciated, or they feel they don't get along with somebody. Let me get one thing straight. I only know one perfect church, and that was Jesus Christ.
Okay.
And what our problem is today is we don't like to face or endure conflict. Mm. What we like to do is we'd rather run for it. We'd rather leave it and not address it versus staying and addressing it. And the thing about it, and it's just like, what happens is you don't grow. You don't flourish. You don't develop. One of the things that God allows us, sometimes he allows conflict and issues to come in our lives to develop us, to flourish us. And when we don't face things that we're supposed to face, we don't grow. And we're going against the will of God.
All right.
And if he didn't lead you in the decision to leave, then you shouldn't leave.
All right. That's right.
You shouldn't leave.
All right.
He has to be in control. He determines that. The church cannot be effective if we have people planted in the wrong local body. And another point I want to bring out, I'm going to stop it with that, but I'm going to move to another one. I want to make sure we clearly understand this. Just because you attend church doesn't mean that you're planted there. There is a difference. We must ask ourselves, church, am I planted in my church, or am I just attending church?
Mm. All right.
Not only is there a lack of leadership, a lack of teaching the true word of God, I understand that. And we need to address that. That is a problem. Our churches aren't teaching and instructing our membership and giving them the knowledge that they need. But we also have believers who are living independently from a divine power system. We're not receiving with the knowledge that's been given. And there's a parable that talks about this. And we talked a little bit about this in Sunday school. In Matthew 13, it discusses how we prevent ourselves from being planted in our local churches. I'm going to go to the parable of the sower. Y'all know about the sower. Y'all know about this. Y'all know where I'm going. Matthew chapter 13. Matthew 13, we're going to look at verses 18 through 23. Get there and say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
He is planning. So it says in verse 18, it says, hear ye therefore the parable of the sword. When anyone hear the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. But he that receives seed in the stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it. Yet hath he not root himself, but endureth for a while when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word of God. By and by he is offended. He is also that receiving seed among the thorns. Is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he that receiveth seed into good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also bear fruit and bringeth forth some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. So we see in this parable that seed along the wayside. Talks about that seed along the wayside, receiving the word of God, but with no understanding. Mm-hmm. We talked about this morning. Sometimes we got leadership and pastors that are not giving sound understanding doctrine so that people can take it and use it and apply it in their daily lives. Mm-hmm. They're confused. And what happens if you, and then we got folks that are distracted, they got other things, and they're receiving the word, the truth is being spoken, but it's not being planted. It's not being planted deep in their heart. And if it's not planted on deep in your heart, then what is it? It's on the surface. And when stuff is on the surface, what happens to it? It's exposed. And because it's exposed, it can easily be taken from you. And that's what happens. You know, the Bible says, guard your heart with all diligence. You know, for out of it are the issues of life. We gotta guard that word that we're given. We can't, and we have to have understanding of it. Amen. Talk about that the seed in the stony places. These are the people when they receive that word, that seed, that the word of God, they receive it with joy. Where's the joy coming from? Is it emotions? It seems like if it's in the word of God, so they receive it with joy, but it had no root system. So when tribulation, they receive it with joy, but when that tribulation and that persecution comes because of the word of God, person becomes offended, word is taken. Gone. It's no development, no flourishing that happens. And then we talked about the seed among the storms. Those that hear the word, but it's choked out because of personal pleasures, because of the cares of the world, things of that sort. We understand how the things of the world are more. Things of the world seem to be more important than the things that we're dealing with than the word of God. We understand they get, and the word gets choked out of us. And then we talked about seed sown on good soil. It flourishes. It bears that seed that's in good ground. It flourishes. It bears fruit, and it multiplies. That's one good thing about the fruit. Not only does the fruit bless you, but it blesses others. Others can pick from your fruit and be blessed by it. Amen? We want to be that seed that's sown on good ground. And I'm going to tell you something. It takes a healthy body of believers in order for the church to be effective in ministry. This applies to the entire body, not just the leadership church, the entire body. It takes the local body as a whole and all the gifts that we have collected, that we have together, to make people mature in Christ, all right? You may have a life calling to do something great, but it will not it will not mature properly if it's not first birthed from being planted in a local church. And I'm just going to repeat the psalmist's words again. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Not only will you flourish now, but this is an eternal blessing that will not only bless you now, but for eternity, church. You got to look at it from that eternal mindset. Amen. The third question that we're going to talk about, and we're going to close out on this question, is this. We need to ask ourselves this. Am I entangled? Am I entangled? We're going to go to Luke 9, and we're going to look at, starting at verse 57. So we're going to talk about a passage in the Bible involving Jesus and some of the followers. But before I get to that, I want to, you know, I remember Paul saying, I think it was somewhere in Acts, he said, I reckon my own life to be nothing to me. He said, I only want to complete my mission and finish the work the Lord Jesus has called me to do. And it made me think about that, because today there are many things that believers that we have in our lives that weigh us down, that prevent us from finding and fulfilling God's purpose in our lives. But the reason why I said this, Paul understood it. He said, my own life is worth nothing to me. He knew his calling. He realized at this point in that scripture, he wasn't finished with his race. And he was focused on fulfilling his calling for Jesus. And just like Paul, the Lord revealed this to Paul, the Lord is revealing this to us as well. When we don't count our lives more valuable than the will of our Heavenly Father, then we'll see that we're truly living, church. The Lord wanted me to share this nugget with you today. And it says, this is something I want you to understand. It's like, when we completely lay down our lives to fulfill God's desire and plan for us, then will we not only discover our calling, but we will fulfill it as well. Mm-hmm. It's one thing to discover, it's a whole other thing to execute. Amen?
Amen.
So, I want to talk about this passage, because in Luke chapter 9, because Jesus was traveling in this passage, and Jesus brought a multitude of people with him. You know, he had the disciples, but he had others that came along for the ride too. You know how people had these entourages, mm-hmm. You know, a bunch of people. So he had a multitude of people following. He was going from one town to another. So as they're traveling, this man comes along. One of the men approaches Jesus. He came along with the disciples and he asked him a question. We're gonna see this in verse 57. It says, and it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. Mm. And Jesus said unto him, foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. So, one of the men approaches Jesus and said, Jesus, I want to follow you wherever you go. And he was full of zeal and excitement. And he's like, man, I got you. He's passionate. I know. He seems sincere. But the one thing about Jesus is he can see through emotions. And he can go straight to the heart where the true motives reside. So Jesus looked at this man spiritually. Now, I'm not talking about from a natural eye. Spiritually, he looked at this man and he said, I see some entanglement in this man. So he responds to him by saying, hey, if you roll with me, you may not have a place to lay your head. Mm. You may not have a place to lay your head at night. You may be laying on rocks. Are you willing to do that? Mm. Are you willing to take that make that sacrifice? And the reason why he said that, Jesus knew he had some entanglement with security in his life. We have securities in our life, don't we? Good job, nice home, city posture pink mattress bed, got a nice 401k. That gives you comfort, huh? Mm-hmm. When you roll with Jesus, you're not going to be comfortable all the time. He's going to get you out of your comfort zone.
Right.
And this guy, Jesus challenged this man with his earthly security by saying, if you choose to follow me, you may not have a place to lay your head. Mm. And so this response probably caused the man to moonwalk. He changed his stance. You know, some people who claim to be, you know, they may claim to be followers of Jesus, but you know what? They just may be fans of Jesus.
Hmm.
You know what a fan will say, I will follow you as long as I can sleep in my own bed. But Jesus doesn't need the support for fans. He needs followers, church. So let's continue on. We're going to move on to verse 59 and 60. It says, and then Jesus speaks to another person that's along the trail with him. He tells the other person, says, follow me. But this person responds and says, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father.
Mm.
Jesus said unto him, let the dead bury the dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. Wow. For some people, including myself at one point in time, when you look at this on the surface, that's like, see what we're talking about? You just have surface understanding. You know, it's on the surface. You don't have good understanding. That's why you gotta study the word. You look at it on the surface, what it look like? Jesus, boy, he's not being very compassionate, is he? He's not being very compassionate at all. You know, but when you study his word, you know, but because you're figuring out what's wrong with burying his father. But when you study the culture of that day, what happened during that day is the inheritance of the firstborn of the father, if he buried his father, he would give a double portion of the inheritance.
Hmm.
If he didn't, then that double portion would go to the second son. So, what was entangling this second person was money. That was his attempt. He didn't say he would follow Jesus like the first person said. He said this. He responded by saying this. He said, let me first. His desires were not about the desires of Jesus. You know?
Hmm.
You know, he would be like, Jesus, I would I got your back. You know, but I'm not going to roll with you to these different cities, but when you come back to my hometown, I'll hook you up. You got a place to stay. Jesus didn't ask him to do that. Mm-hmm. Jesus told him he wanted him to go and preach the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
He was entangled in money. Money was his entanglement. Nothing, church, can come before the will of God if we're going to discover and fulfill this plan for our lives. And I'm telling you, many believers today fall into the same trap in addressing their priorities over being obedient to God's plan for them. And what happens in the end is their plans end up going up in smoke, like it says in the title scripture, church. It goes up in smoke.
Mm-hmm.
All for naught. Third person, verse 61, says another said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell, which are at my home and my house. And Jesus said to him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
So the crowd, can you imagine, this first person's left, you know, he's been, Jesus responded to him, he probably drifts off. This second person is drifting off. probably not only them, you got some people that's listening too, right? Mm-hmm. So they, after they hear some of this stuff, they probably drifting off truth. So the crowd is dwindling down. So this last person comes up and he said, yeah, I will follow you, Jesus, but let me first go talk to my peoples. You know, I need to talk to my, let me say goodbye to my peoples. You know, it could be his family, friends, girl, he may have a significant other, girlfriend or whatever, wife. So he wants to discuss his decision with those people before he leaves to go with Jesus Christ. I need to holler at my people. That's where the problem lies. Allowing relationships with family, friends, and loved ones to take precedent over following Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Don't we see this impacting our believers today?
Yes.
They're not being planted in the churches that they're supposed to be planted in because they're being influenced by family members.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
We see this happening every day. And because they're not flourishing in the courts of God, we can't let anybody, any other relationship. Our most important relationship is our vertical relationship with God, the Father, Jesus, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen? So we get to this third person, Jesus responds to him. So we see these three major areas of entanglement. Security. Comfort, that's what I like to call comfort. Money and relationship. I know there are others, but those are the three main ones that we cover. But what I want you to see is as we, a lot of times we read this passage, but we fail to read what comes up in the next chapter, because we know these chapters were done by the church, but this chapter 10 runs together with chapter 9, the end of chapter 9. Look at what chapter 10 says. It says, after these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also, and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place, whether he himself would come. Therefore he said unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few.
Mm-hmm.
Woo!
Mm-hmm.
The crowd has dwindled down, and now there's only a remnant of people who have remained committed to following Jesus. So he chooses, he appoints the 70. No telling how many it could have been. It could have been 7,000. Could have been 70,000. But now it's down to 70. You know, the scripture says in Matthew, it says, for many are called, for few are chosen. You know that? Now, everyone is called, church. As believers, we all have a calling upon our life. And we are equipped. We are equipped. He's already finished the work. He's equipped us with the grace to accomplish it. But few are chosen and appointed to fulfill that call, because only a few will forsake their entanglement to fulfill the call upon their lives.
Mm-hmm.
The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Church, we can't blame God for why the church is having problems reaching others. He's equipped us with everything that we need. The problem is, it's not with God, the problem is with ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we fulfill our calling that God has given us, then we will not be judged.
Mm-hmm.
But if we allow entanglements to bind us and keep us from the calling that God has called us to, we will be judged. And some of you may say, well, I'm only one of me. I'm going to give you an example. What if your kidney just woke up one day? This decided one day it's gonna stop functioning.
Mm-hmm.
He told everybody, I don't want to function no more. What would happen to the rest of the body?
Mm-hmm.
It would have an impact on the rest of the body, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Every part of the body of Christ is important, no matter how big.
Amen.
Or small.
Amen.
No matter how big or small, we all play an integral role. What we fail to not understand is multiplication. All we have to do today, the word is being brought forth. And we're all here receiving it. Think about if we all took the word today and we shared it with somebody, and they shared it with five other people, and they shared it with 10 other people. Think about the impact that it has on people. All it took is one person. Think about the person who saved Billy Graham. Did you realize he's responsible for all the people that Billy Graham led to Christ? People don't think about that. Because I impacted one life, that could trigger other lives. Your work is not going to be done. It's not done in void. Think about this. And some people may say, you know, God is saying it's only a few that fulfill their duties as subcontractors. And it may seem disheartening. You know, many's going to suffer loss at the judgment seat because they did not follow the calling that God has given them. And not gain those eternal rewards, those benefits that happen to us now and later. And some of us say, wow, this ain't good. I'm going to tell you something. I think this is good news for us today. Mm-hmm. You know why? Because we can start today by praying to the Lord, applying our rebound tool, confess our sin to the Lord privately, and whatever is preventing us from obeying His will for our life, and then we can start moving forward to walking in His plan and His will for us. I'm going to give you an example, and I'm going to close out. There's an evangelist named Smith Wigglesworth. He was a 20th century evangelist, and he was one of the greatest evangelists during the 20th century. Do you know when he started his ministry? He was in his 50s when he started. Hmm. Even though he was in his 50s, he still had a great impact. So it doesn't matter what time. Today, why not here? Why not now? Why not right now, church? Just remember these keys in building a sound home in the kingdom of God. The first thing we got to do is seek God in faith. Second thing we need to do is plant ourselves in the local church that God shows us. And we got to stay submitted and obedient to the leadership of that ministry. And the third thing we got to do, remove the entanglements in our lives, church. So, you know, as God, I hope God, as He spoke to you today, I hope He's revealed any type of weights that may keep you from fulfilling the calling that God has upon your life. And I hope that the word, that sword of the Spirit, I hope that that word severs those ties that have on your soul that's weighing you down from keeping you from your calling. I'm telling you, church, His grace is it's more sufficient. More than sufficient to free you from those things that are binding you up. So just make sure that you understand that. And just know, if you start and you fall, find out what caused you to fall. Ask God, repent, get yourself back to where you are, and start over again. Don't give up. Keep pushing. Amen?
Amen.
The key is to stay connected to God's divine power system. So I want y'all to do that. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.